I'm here with Steven Raichlen and his new book, The Brisket Chronicles. You've taken on the hardest topic in barbecuing.
And beyond.
Yes.
Yeah, I call brisket the Mount Everest of barbecue. If you can scale it, ascend it, you can cook anything.
Right.
Yeah.
In here, you talk about sous-viding brisket, and you talk about...
But then I did the vampire kind of thing, right?
You said that brisket is struggle.
Yes.
And the truly good brisket comes from that struggle.
Well, absolutely. You think about the anatomy of brisket. First of all, it's a barbecue that should never be, right? Because it's two separate muscles connected by a seam of fat. One of them is extremely lean. One of them is extremely fatty. The grains of the two muscles run at about an 80-degree angle to one another. So carving it, you know, slicing it is almost impossible. And when you barbecue a brisket, you have to figure out a way to cook both of those muscles, the lean part so it stays moist, the fatty part so it renders the fat, the whole thing so it becomes tender. So it really is a very challenging kind of meat to cook.
And the cooking of those two different kinds of meat is multi-staged as well. Is that correct?
Yeah, it actually, I think it took me about 4 pages to go through the 11 steps to brisket nirvana, but first of all, selecting the meat, I mean, that's really important, right? Because you can go prime, you can go choice, you can go Wagyu.
Right.
And then if you're shopping in a typical supermarket, what you're likely to find is the flat, that's the lean muscle. But you know, if you really want to do the big kahuna, you need to get a whole packer brisket, which you typically get at a butcher shop, unless you're in Texas, and then you can find it at a supermarket.
And that's a 14-pound piece of meat.
Could be anywhere from 12 on the small side up to 18 on the big side. So yeah, it's the largest cut of meat most of us will ever bring into our homes to cook.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So we went very deep and very geek just now in terms of the brisket stuff, and I know that that's your audience. I'd like to talk a little bit about when you were looking into this and you were going worldwide, what you found when you were writing the book.
Well, I'm so glad you asked. Let me reassure people that barbecue is a large part of this book. It's probably half this book, but that's not the whole brisket story, not by a long shot. So let's travel around the world. Texas, barbecued brisket. Kansas City, barbecued brisket, but very different. Right. New York City, we're in the realm of delicatessen, so we find pastrami, which if you take a jump up to Montreal, becomes smoked meat, prepared in a similar but slightly different manner that gives you very different results. Then we jump across the pond. Ireland, the birthplace of corned beef, which has been around for 8 centuries.
Right.
We go to France, where I did my culinary training after college, and I was a French literature major, so I used to eat something called bœuf à la mode, which was a brisket braised in red wine with mushrooms, bacon, and onions.
Right.
Fantastic. Down to Germany, we find Bierfleisch, which is brisket braised with caramelized onions and beer, a preparation that is reprised in the Flemish-speaking parts of Belgium, where it's known as carbonade.
Right.
And you know, if you jump down to the Caribbean, Cuba has something called vaca frita, which is a boiled, shredded brisket that's fried with onions and garlic, deep fried. So those little filaments get crispy.
Wow.
You know,
is that sliced when it's prepared?
No. It's you boil the brisket, and then when it's still warm, with 2 forks, you shred it. And the finer you shred it, if you really do it right, the shreds of brisket are as thin as angel hair pasta. And then you deep fry and they get crispy with the onions.
So it's like a cloud.
It's like crisp brisket cotton candy with garlic. That's pretty amazing. But you know, you can continue around the world. You know, in Kashmir, you find Nehiri Gosht, which is a brisket braised with spices. You jump down to Korea, and you find, this is really cool, because you know, common wisdom says brisket must be cooked low and slow, right? Low heat, long time, either in a pit. Well, you want to win $100 with a bar bet. Bet somebody I can cook a brisket in 1 minute from start to finish.
Right.
So what the Koreans do is they freeze it.
Right.
They put it on a meat slicer, slice it paper thin, and then those paper thin slices you can grill on a hibachi in 30 seconds per side.
Wow.
And the way it's served is really cool too. on a lettuce leaf with chili jam with Korean pickles. So it's sort of barbecue health food.
Right, and that's the way a lot of the meat in Korea is served, right?
It's, yeah.
With that taco of lettuce.
Yeah, yeah. Well, also in Vietnam, I say brisket's apotheosis is in Vietnam, where it's boiled for the better part of a day to make the broth for pho, which is Vietnamese beef noodle soup.
Sure.
And then my favorite version of pho, they take the brisket, they thinly slice it on a meat slicer, and that floats on top. So it's pretty extraordinary.
Right.
I mean, and there's so many cultures that call brisket their own.
Yeah.
And I think it's a comfort food in every single one of them.
Now, does when you cook the pho and you have the brisket, is there flavor left in the brisket?
Definitely.
Right.
But
it's because of the cut, right?
Right.
It's because of the...
Because there's so much flavor in it. Because let's remember, brisket comes from the chest of the steer.
Right.
It's a load-bearing muscle.
Right.
It's the muscle the steer uses to locomote, to get up when it's laying down. So it's extremely well exercised.
Right.
You know, not like beef tenderloin, which is
nothing.
Just nothing.
It just lies around his whole life.
Right.
So, and that's what makes all different cuts tender or not tender is how much work they do.
How much work they do. Yeah, and brisket is loaded with it's protein called collagen.
Right.
And it's a triple helix of protein strands that wrap around the meat fibers. And the whole key to cooking brisket, whether you're braising it, whether you're barbecuing it, whether you're boiling it, is you have to melt that, transform that collagen into gelatin.
And that's done at a specific temperature, right? I mean,
it starts about 140 degrees.
Right.
And then if you're barbecuing, I think it's probably the collagen conversion, mostly done by 180. Although if you have brisket in Kansas City, where they typically cook to 185, it's a little firmer, a little tougher. They slice it super thin on a meat slicer and pile it on a bun for a sandwich.
Right.
Whereas the Texans go to about 205. We really are getting geeky here.
It's all right. Sometimes we got to go there, right?
Yeah.
Especially with the brisket,
yeah.
Because it's such a difficult meat to cook well.
Yeah.
Well,
you know, it's funny. Yes, it's difficult.
Yeah.
If you're barbecuing it, but braising it, you throw a brisket in a sealed pot with a flavorful liquid like wine. My Ananette used to use Manischewitz.
Right.
And either aromatic root vegetables like onion, celery, carrot, or sweet fruits like prunes, apricots, and raisins.
Right.
Put it in the oven for 3 hours and forget it.
Yeah.
So.
And serve it in that state. You don't brown it off or anything.
Yeah. And I have kind of a cool trick for that, which actually I learned from my wife.
Yeah.
Which is, when braising the brisket, you slice it halfway through, because it's. If you wait until it's completely soft and done, it's kind of hard to cut into neat slices unless you use...
Because it falls apart.
Right, unless you use an electric knife.
Right.
So you slice it halfway through, put it back in the braising liquid and finish cooking it.
Right, and that way all the slices get the benefit of the braising
you
liquid.
Bet.
Yeah.
You bet,
yeah.
You bet.
Huh. So, and what the way I understand barbecue is that for a long time it's been a very competitive field, right?
Yeah.
And people have very strong feelings about their hometown. This is one thing you talk about in the book, is that, you know, certain kinds of wood are required for barbecue, and it tends to be, as you, I think, so reasonably say, is that it usually is the wood that's nearest to the barbecue pit.
Right.
But people get very intense about which is the right wood to use, and sometimes range around. But it's always been a very competitive field, and something's changing now.
Absolutely, and that is, well, Two answers to that question. So in the field of barbecue restaurants, I think much less competitive. Like Billy Durney, with whom I was last night. Billy Durney is the owner of Hometown Barbecue in Red Hook, Brooklyn.
Which is fantastic. Yeah.
Best buddies with Wayne Miller, Mueller down in Texas. Best buddies with Aaron Franklin. In fact, Aaron Franklin built his pits. So these guys are these are the brisket brethren.
Right.
However, on the competition barbecue circuit, it's still pretty competitive.
Right.
And there's a big difference between a competition brisket and a restaurant brisket.
Oh yeah, what's
so
that?
Competition, okay. So you've got maybe 60 teams all submitting brisket at the same time to be judged.
Right.
So they're trying to differentiate their brisket as much as possible. First of all, they're cooking flats because you get a prettier slice to look at.
Right.
They're probably injecting, maybe with a mixture of bouillon and melted butter. They're putting a rub. They're certainly putting a sweet glaze on because, you know, our brains are hardwired to respond favorably to salt, fat, and sweet.
Right.
Whereas a restaurant brisket, it's salt, pepper, and wood smoke. You know, that's it. Just super simple.
Now, Tootsie at Snow's in Lexington, Texas is a great example of a salt and pepper restaurant.
Absolutely. It's called a Dalmatian rub because it's, you know, a half or some proportion of coarse salt and some proportion of cracked or coarsely ground black pepper. So speckled black and white like right. I like to make, by the way, a little variation on that. It's called a newspaper rub. It's black and white with red pepper flakes in it. Nice. So black and white, red all over. Get it. Which I'm sure millennials won't know because they don't read newspapers.
Right.
But
bless them.
Oh, well. But anyway, the other thing Tootsie does, you know, at some point during the cooking process, you wrap a brisket. That's usually about 2/3 in. And the Aaron Franklin School holds that you wrap the brisket in unlined butcher paper. Right. So it seals on moistness and yet it breathes, so it doesn't trap in the steam. Tootsie Tomanez, 85 years old and still up at 2 a.m. light in the pit every morning, uses what's called the Texas crutch, and she wraps her brisket in aluminum foil. Now, I once got into a Twitter war with the late Anthony Bourdain about wrapping, and he thought that was a terrible thing to do to a brisket.
Foil. Yeah, yeah. Is that where the crutch comes from? It's a little bit of a nudge there.
Well, what it does, what the tinfoil does is it sort of turns the process in barbecuing into braising, right? You're trapping the steam, so you're doing exactly what my Aunt Annette did.
Right.
When she and I
with the Manischewitz.
Well, with the sealed pot,
right?
You know, braising the sealed pot.
Yeah.
I used to use the Texas crutch. I don't anymore because I find it results in a slightly pot roasty consistency, and even the Snow's brisket, you know, which is a fabulous brisket, but there's that pot roasty quality. It brings us back to that whole notion of struggle.
Right.
You know, I want a brisket. When I'm eating a brisket, I want some parts to be a little tougher. I want some parts to be a little softer and more tender.
Right.
I want some parts to be a little burnt. I want other parts to be kind of, you know, it's that incredible variation.
Yes.
You taste the struggle. You taste conquering the struggle of cooking a brisket.
Right, the victory.
The victory,
yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, and it's
you know, if you could climb them, if there were an elevator to the top of a mountain, you know, nobody would be free solo, right?
That's exactly right. The level of detail is astounding to people who aren't, for folks who are just getting into this. The grind of the pepper, number 18.
Big deal.
Right? People have really strong feelings about how big the pepper, how coarse the pepper is.
Oh my God, and the proportions, you know, Billy Durney is, Aaron Franklin is 1-to-1, Billy Durney is 4-to-1, Wayne Mueller is 8-to-1.
Right.
You know.
And they all get along.
They all get along. And you know what, their briskets are all fabulous.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's the important thing, yeah.
You know what's also amazing about brisket, a barbecued brisket, like, this is the brisket moment. And it's the brisket moment, first of all, because it's on everybody's mind. Everybody wants to eat it. Everybody wants to cook it. People are even writing books about brisket. But 50 years ago, you couldn't even buy a barbecued brisket in Texas.
Right.
The first restaurant to serve it was Black's. And before that, Tootsie Tomanez, when she was a younger woman, she had a butcher shop. They used to grind the brisket up and make hamburger out of it. Who would ever want to eat barbecued brisket,
right.
She said.
Right. So what changed and why is this a celebrated cut now? Is it because of the difficulty? Because people learn to conquering, you know?
Well, I think, historically what changed is the way meat was distributed changed. And we went from hanging meat, which was whole or half carcasses that were sold to butcher shops that would break them down,
right.
to boxed meat, where the beef is broken down at the meatpacking plant and then sold cryovac'd in boxes.
Right.
So all of a sudden, this cut that never used to be separated from the shoulder cut, now the shoulder was broken into many different cuts and the brisket was sold separately.
Right. And even at 14 pounds, more manageable than when it was attached to the shoulder.
Exactly. Yeah, and interestingly, in Texas, the first written mention of the word brisket was 1910, and it wasn't at a barbecue joint, it was at a Jewish grocery store.
Wow.
Where you could get it smoked, you could get it braised. And pastrami, of course, pastrami starts as brisket,
right?
Right. So, but that wasn't always the case either. That's a really fascinating story.
It started as naval, right?
Well, even before that. So, you know, we go back to the Ottoman Empire, and in the Middle East today, there's a dish called pastourma, right, which is long strips of meat coated with spices, one of which is garlic, and sweet spices like mace. And pastourma was a cured meat. It was salted but not smoked. It gradually moved west to Romania, right, where tons of garlic were added. Remember, this is vampire country. And people used the cheapest meat, which at the time was goose. Mm. And at one point, that was a huge business. Then Romanians started immigrating to New York's Lower East Side at the turn of the last century. And they found beef at incredibly reasonable prices. So they started pastramiing beef. And along the way, they invented a restaurant where you could eat pastrami. It became known as the delicatessen.
Right.
And beef navel, you're right, that's the equivalent of a pork belly, but in a steer, was the traditional or the original meat for pastrami.
And it's similar, the cut?
Yes and no. It's much fattier. It's much, the layers are much more striated. It's tougher.
Right.
There's still one place that serves pastrami made with beef navel. That's Katz's Deli.
Right.
But most of the other places have switched, I think, quite felicitously to brisket.
Right. One of the elements in this book is how the pros judge brisket. Can you talk to us a bit about what they're looking for? And
well, absolutely. So first of all, let's talk about doneness. Okay.
Right.
So, and every pro you meet will swear that he never uses a thermometer, that they don't even own thermometers. Meanwhile, you go to Aaron Franklin's there, probing with these Bistic thermometers in every possible corner
right,
of the brisket. But you're looking for, it's been described sometimes as it sort of jiggles like jello.
Right.
That's one
test.
Meat
jello.
Meat jello, meat jello. But a couple tests. So thermometer, 205 degrees. If you're using with the bend method, you slide a insulated gloved hand under the brisket, lift it up, and if it droops like a sad mustache,
right,
you're in business. Another test is you take one end, you shake it, it'll jiggle like jello.
Right.
Another
in a wave, like a rivulet.
You bet. Right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then you can take a chopstick, and if you can insert a chopstick through the brisket, it's tender enough.
Okay.
In terms of judging the quality of a brisket, so I mean, first of all, you look at it, should be almost jet black. It should have on the outside, we call it a bark, and it's a sort of semi-crusty, salty, smoky, crisp layer on the surface.
Right.
Then underneath, if you've done it right, you'll find a subcutaneous layer of a sort of a reddish pink,
right,
that goes from anywhere from an eighth to about a half an inch into the meat. That's the smoke ring, a naturally occurring chemical reaction between the nitrous oxide and smoke, and the CO2 in smoke, and the hemoglobin in the meat.
Huh.
The meat itself should be tender enough to, you hold it up, you can pull it apart,
right,
but it should not fall apart,
right,
okay? You taste it should be luscious, it should be moist, you press your fork against it, you see the juices come to the surface, you bite into it, it should be tender, but so still, you know, it's not baby food.
Right,
yeah,
right, yeah. That's something,
yeah.
Yeah. And one final thing occurred to me as you were talking was that the quality of the meat isn't necessarily a judge of how good the cut is going to be at the end. People don't use prime just reflexively. That there are other qualities.
Very interesting. Yeah. So I started this book at a place called Camp Brisket, which is a 48-hour seminar put on by Texas A&M University's meat department,
right,
meat science department. And, well, you know, we learned about brisket anatomy. It's the only school I've ever been where they wheel out a whole steer carcass and the students don't recoil with horror, but they lick their chops in anticipation.
Right.
And they did a series of blind tests. One of them is that they smoked a select, a choice, and a prime brisket, the same method. And interestingly, the one that was preferred in a blind tasting was the choice, not the prime.
Right.
Most of the guys these days are using prime, but Tootsie Tomanez uses select. You know, that's sort of a commercial food grade.
Right, right.
And she was named number one in Texas Monthly, so, you know.
Right.
Yeah. And so, I mean, art plays a big part of it. The other thing that's happening, I think, is really interesting, is that, you know, it's the old Michael Pollan Where your meat comes from and how it's raised matters as much as how you smoke it.
Right.
And people are really paying attention to want to source animals that are humanely raised. There's a couple down in Asheville, actually the outside of Charlotte, North Carolina, that cook only grass-fed briskets. Huh. Now, grass-fed's harder because it's leaner.
Right.
But, you know, I mean, you got to have a conscience.
Right. Yeah.
You got to have a conscience.
Yeah, that's right. And so, amazing details, and there are so many more in Steven Raichlen's book, The Brisket Chronicles. It's a fantastic book. Steven, thank you so much.
Thank you.
For coming in. It's a great pleasure.